Hello and welcome to today's webinar presented by the National Institute on Retirement Security on a new report, Retirement Insecurity 2024, Americans' Views of Retirement. A few notes ahead of today's discussion. All participants are in listen-only mode, but are able to submit questions using the Zoom question function at the bottom of your screen. Feel free to submit questions at any time throughout the presentation. There will be a designated question and answer session at the end. Moving on to today's speakers, we have Dan Doonan, Executive Director at NIRS and co-author of the report, and Kelly Kenneally, NIRS Communications Consultant and co-author of the report. With that, I will turn things over to Dan Doonan.
Okay, thank you, Margaret. And I want to thank everyone for joining us today. We really appreciate the opportunity to share this work with you and have a chance to walk through more fully what we found in our research. So, if we go to the next slide, why have we looked at this research? Well, when NIRS was founded, there was really a big unknown. What do Americans think about pensions? I think those of us in the industry talked about it a lot. But as far as having a lot of polling or information like that out there about Americans' views towards pensions, there wasn't a lot out there. So NIRS began doing polling. And about every other year, we come back and update our research or on the public opinion work that we do. And we intentionally chose a polling firm with expertise in the financial services to work with for this project. And we'll, next slide we'll mention, but it's Greenwald Research, and they also do the retirement confidence survey done by EBRI. So they have a lot of experience in this area, and we want to thank them for the work they do with us, as we enjoy working with them. Now, we modified, I should note, you know, all of our past research is available on our website under the research tab, but I should note that the methodology did change in 2018 as polling has been moving to more online surveys and less phone calls. So if you look at old results and new results, they're not perfectly comparable because of the methodology change. But the results are there if you're interested in looking back. And the first report, you know, that we did was in 2009, and it's really evolved and grown over time. And we've started to really break out some more, you know, more zoomed in on different areas with this research. So on the next slide, as I mentioned, Greenwald Research did the polling for us, and the information was collected online during interviews between October 10th and 25th of 2023. And that's going to be a little bit important as we talk about inflation. And they surveyed 1,208 individuals age 25 and older in the survey, and the final date were weighted by age, gender, income to reflect the demographics of Americans age 25 and older. And with that, I'm going to hand it over to Kelly. And you're on mute.
You think I'd have that mastered after 4 years of Zoom life, right? So thanks so much, everyone, for joining us today. And thanks for tuning in to hear more about the polling research. It's a project I love working on with NIRS, and I think it just provides so much important data for all of us who work in the retirement sector. So turning to the next slide, we're going to run through five key findings today. I'll take some, Dan will take a couple, and we'll kind of run through each of those with you. The first key finding is that Americans express strong support for pensions. As Dan mentioned, when NIRS was first founded, there wasn't a lot of research out there about pensions. I know when I first came on board with NIRS, what was available to me was a lot of the news coverage about pensions, and it was all very negative. Americans think pensions are dinosaurs, they're outdated, they're too expensive. And the more I learned about pensions, I'm like, well, this doesn't really jive with like how pensions really are structured. So, you know, what is it that Americans really think? We're just kind of relying on news reports of what Americans think. So we launched the public opinion polling with a big focus on really diving in and understanding what Americans think about pensions. And then you'll see on the bottom of the slide, NIRS asked Americans to describe the ways in which your vision of retirement has changed. Every year we have an open-ended question where people can can just kind of share their thoughts, what they think about a certain question. They don't have to pick, you know, an A or a B answer. And throughout the report, if you've read that, and then throughout this presentation, we've shared with you some of the verbatim quotes that we got from individuals about their sentiment about retirement. Some of them are really compelling, and sometimes they're just really kind of make you sad to see what people feel about their retirement outlook. So on the next slide, you can see here that this is a question that we've asked all the way back from the beginning, but we've only got trended data here from 2019, as Dan mentioned, because we changed the polling methodology. But you can see here that over time, Americans really have consistently favorable views about pensions. This year, the numbers were 78% were favorable, just up slightly from the 2 years ago from 76. And back in 2019, it was at 77%. So like when I read these results, I often think to myself, like, what is it about pensions that people consistently have those favorable views? And I think a lot of it has to do with the benefits of pensions and sort of the features of them, that they're easy, kind of set it and forget it. You don't have to worry about managing all your investments. They're safe and secure and those kind of things. So I think that's probably a lot of the reason that drives Americans' favorable views of pensions. So on the next slide, the other thing we wanted to know about pensions is, did people feel like they're going to be there? And you can see here from this slide, we've got very strong numbers again on that, 81% for 2023, 81% back in 2020. So it stayed consistent. And it dipped a little bit from 2019, where it had it at 85%. So this was an important thing to understand for us, just because sometimes people will not feel secure about their retirement. But for pensions, they do feel secure that their pension benefit will be there. So if you contrast it to, say, like a 401k, although 401ks definitely have their place in the retirement equation, and they're, you know, a very important tool out there. We all know that 401k balances can fluctuate up and down. You know, people will sometimes take money out of their 401k plan, so it leaves their retirement nest egg a little bit depleted. So pensions are something that you can't really borrow from. So, you know, there's a lot of reasons why pensions are strong. There's laws in place to protect pensions. So it's a lot, there's a lot of confidence there, and that pensions are going to be there, and you can rely on that income when you retire. And on the next slide, we'll see. 77% of Americans say that pensions make Americans more likely to have a secure retirement. So again, you can see here that there's strong numbers in this regard too. So again, all across the board, strong results on pensions. And then on the next slide, the American dream is something that is so much a part of the American lexicon and culture. So we wanted to frame a question in terms of, like, what does the pension mean as related to the American dream? And if you've read the report, we did a little bit of a write-up about what exactly the American dream is, because I was kind of curious. I always hear about the American dream, but I'm like, what exactly is it and what's the history of it? But just a little interesting factoid, that term was coined in 1931 in a book called The Epic of America by James Truslow Adams, and he calls it the American dream is the dream that everyone should be better, richer, and fuller for everyone in America. So I thought that was kind of interesting. So I really wanted to dive into, like, what pensions do for the American dream, because there's so many, there's so much out there that the American dream is, like, dying, or, you know, the American dream is impossible for so many people now. And a lot of that's related to, you know, wages or inflation or housing is so out of reach. But I really wanted to understand for this research, what piece of the equation do pensions play? And you can see here, it's a big part of it. So 77% of Americans say that because pensions aren't widely available anymore, it's really affecting the American dream. And if you read any of the media coverage too about this report that's come out, a lot of the reporters do kind of zero in on this question and talk about the American dream and how it's related to pensions. And then on the next slide, the other thing we wanted to do was compare how Americans feel about 401ks and pensions. Again, 401ks are an important part of the retirement equation, sort of that three-legged stool, Social Security, pension, 401ks. But we wanted to understand what Americans think about pensions. in terms of delivering retirement security as compared to 401ks. And not really surprisingly, most Americans see pensions as better. 65% in 2023, 65% in 2020, and then just dipping a little bit, 63% in 2019. So again, 401ks definitely have a place and a role in retirement, but those of you who've been involved with retirement, you know, for a while know that pensions, 401ks were not intended to replace pensions, and they weren't set up to replace pensions. So, but in practicality in the private sector, that's essentially what's happened. Pensions have gone by the wayside and been replaced by 401ks. So, you know, 401ks can go up and down. People can put money in them, they don't put money in, they can leak, like I talked about before. So just because of some of those attributes of 401k plans, most people see pensions as better as delivering retirement security as compared to those 401k plans. And then on the next slide, this question gets into why Americans should have a pension. So we frame the question of, are pensions important because of they create independence and self-reliance for Americans as they get older? And, you know, like independence and self-reliance, kind of like the American dream, is very much a part of the American culture and lexicon. So we wanted to understand how important pensions are in terms of delivering those two factors, independence and self-reliance. And you can see here, it's very important. 82% of Americans agree with that. You know, I wanted to frame the question like that rather than pensions are, you know, something that's deserved, because that was a lot of the messaging that I would see in the news media, that pensions are deserved. And of course, if you've put in a career and earned your pension, of course, they're like an earned benefit and part of your overall compensation. But I thought it would be important to frame it and really understand how Americans see pensions in terms of like independence and self-reliance. So you can see here that it was very important. Then on the next slide, here's a question. This is a new question for us this year. There's actually three new questions. And we often talk about pensions in terms of being a magnet, in terms of like attracting and retaining workers. It's something that's appealing to workers. So they may come to a job because it has a pension, because they want that safety and security of retirement income that they'll get after serving a career in a job. And we also wanted to understand if pensions are something that keep workers in their jobs. So if another job offer came along, would that pension attract them and keep them in their job? So you can see here, pretty high numbers. The first question we asked people was if you had a choice between a job with a pension or a 401k, 51% of Americans said they would take that job with a pension. So slight edge there. And then when it comes to keeping your workers, figure 11, that question was for workers without a pension. So if you have a pension and you had another job offer, are you more likely to stay? And those workers with a pension said they are likely to stay longer in their job if they have a pension. And then in figure 12, that question was framed to workers without a pension. And they said if they did have a pension, they would be more likely to stay in their job. So you can see this effect of pensions is really important today, because we have a very tight labor force. And, you know, I don't think that tight labor market is going anywhere anytime soon, just because of the demographic numbers that we see for the U.S. So pensions can really be an advantage for an employer who wants a workforce that's going to be there for a career. So, you know, certainly there's jobs and industries where, you know, you have a lot of turnover, and that's fine for that particular industry. But in some industries, you really want to keep an experienced workforce, especially like in public safety, police, firefighters, teachers. You want teachers to serve a career and be in their job for a long time. Even I've been thinking about it also, too, with all the issues going on with Boeing right now, and they've got all their safety issues and things. It makes me think like, well, you know, are they getting a lot of employee turnover and that kind of thing? So, you know, jobs where you want people that have a lot of experience and you want them to stay for a career, pensions, you know, definitely can be advantageous for employers. And then on the next slide, I will turn it over to Dan here, and he's going to talk about the next key finding. Dan?
All right. Thank you, Kelly. And I should stop and take a moment here. I failed to thank Kelly. Kelly was played a huge role in this project. And as I was talking about Greenwald, I meant to mention that. So a big thanks to the work Kelly's done on this project, bringing it to where we are. It was an awful lot of work. So, okay, back on topic here. I'm going to talk about our second key finding. There's a lot of anxiety around retirement. In terms of, you know, people's views, this survey was in the field late last year, I mentioned. Thankfully, inflation has tamed a bit. But at that point in time, we really saw in the responses, inflation kept coming up a lot in terms of what are people's concerns around retirement. And you see that in the comment here, where the respondent talked about how inflation impacted how far their dollars went, their income, their medicines, and things like that. Now, on the next slide, we ask Americans if they agree that the U.S. faces a retirement crisis. And this is another question that we have asked over time. So there's some trend history there as well. 79% agree that the U.S. faces a retirement crisis. The next question we're going to actually ask about what they see about their situation. But, you know, Americans seem to understand there are gaps in our retirement infrastructure. We often hear how about half of workers have a plan in the workplace. That's a big gap. You know, people are far less likely to save. So people really do seem to understand that. I would note that there's actually more people that said, I don't know, than strongly disagree. So I think, you know, Americans understand the challenges we have on retirement. And on the next slide, here we talked about whether or not an individual feels like they are confident they'll have a secure retirement. And, you know, this is much more people responding about themselves. And 56% said yes, with 21% being very concerned about their ability to have a secure retirement. Only 15% were not concerned at all. And I would note that, you know, the two green bars together, both positive responses, it's roughly in line with what we see in the National Retirement Risk Index 2.0 from the Center on Boston College, Center on Retirement Research at Boston College. And they found basically about half of households will not be able to maintain their standard of living in retirement. So the individual responses are pretty closely in line with the academic work on this area. And on the next slide, we ask about different factors that, you know, are going to impact people in terms of their retirement. What are they concerned about? Again, inflation scored really high in this particular edition. But there are other things as well, you know, it's harder to save, had to cut into savings. We see cash outs as being a challenge on the savings side. Have to work longer. You know, there's a lot of issues that people are laying out there, health costs, you know, lost jobs, things like that, that are really setting people back in terms of retirement preparation. And if we can go to the next slide. Here we ask, can the average worker save enough on their own? You know, do you agree that it's increasingly difficult for average worker to save on their own? Again, we see 77% say yes, 38 strongly agreeing. And I think, you know, this is part of the conversation we've had, I think, nationally about the middle class. You know, for a long time, it seemed like the middle class was growing, it was getting stronger, more robust. And, you know, we see more holes in the, you know, security, I think, of the middle class in many different ways. But you see it on participation of retirement plans as well, where the middle class is really kind of spotty in terms of having access to a plan. And in addition to that, you know, you're making enough money that Social Security is not going to be that generous. You really do have to have something besides Social Security. So in the next slide. There we go. We also ask, you know, do you think employers should contribute more money towards workers' retirement to allow them to have secure retirement. And 80% did agree with that, with 37% strongly agreeing. And I will say, you know, when private employers move from pensions to offering defined contribution, not only was there a risk shift, which I think we're all familiar with, but there was a cost shift there too. You know, the public sector workers typically pay a lot into their pension, but private pensions were largely company funded. And you do see here a desire to see employers sort of step up their efforts in response to these challenges. So on the next slide, 70% are saying that, you know, it's going to be harder in the future to have a secure retirement. It's, you know, retirement is getting more challenging, and that is up significantly. You know, there's good reason to feel this way. You know, we talk about, you know, we're going to live longer in the future than we do now, just like longevity has been improving. Health costs for many years have outpaced wage growth, right? So when you think about having resources for healthcare and retirement, you're going to live longer, health costs are outpacing. That means, you know, essentially more of a need to save during your working years, a higher share to deal with those health costs. And, you know, we often hear about working longer and things like that. So I think as you look at the major trends on retirement, you know, the trends that really drive the numbers, most of them are moving in a direction where we'll need more of our working income to be reserved for retirement to sort of maintain that standard of living. And on the next slide, you know, the disappearance of pensions, really we ask about a lot of different areas here. And again, high inflation was mentioned. There's strong support across the board. I think we'll credit Kelly for asking about the right issues here in terms of, you know, what people are worried about. So in addition to high inflation, the cost of healthcare, long-term care, we're strongly agreed to. We'll come back to long-term care towards the end. And middle salaries not increasing and fewer pensions are also, you know, some top reasons that, you know, retirement is challenging. So on the next slide, this is a new question for us. You know, in a savings-based world where a lot of employer plans are putting aside money, individuals invest, they're going to have to figure out life income in retirement. You know, in order to set a reasonable savings target, we feel like you need to have some sense of, okay, if you have a certain amount of money, how much does that translate into income? So we ask, if you had a $100,000 nest egg, how much income would that provide you in retirement? And we did say annually in retirement, so it implied ongoing. And what we see here is 29% thought they could generate $20,000 in retirement income per year or more with a $100,000 nest egg. So, you know, if you think about living possibly 30 years or more in retirement, you know, they're expecting to withdraw about, you know, 20% or more and get that level of income. Another 26% suggested $10,000 to $20,000 in income. So you have a lot of people that have fairly high expectations in terms of income levels that they can get. On the other side of it, there's a significant number of answers, less than 1,000 or less than 2,000. Now for this chart, we really looked at the reasonable responses as being those right around the 4% rule. When you think about converting savings to income, the conversation usually starts by explaining the 4% rule. If you have $100,000, plan to take about $4,000 in the first year, $4,000 plus inflation in the later years. And that's often seen as a drawdown level that there's a very high probability you won't run out of funds. So, you know, I was actually asked about, in response to this question, about buying annuities. And of course, annuities prices are going to change with markets over time. So we really just based this on the 4% rule and thought that would be a good basis to compare the responses that we received. So I think it's somewhat alarming that, you know, as much as we do education on sort of asset classes and investing, I found it somewhat alarming that there wasn't a good sense of the level of income you were going to get from $100,000, which really we kind of looked at because we thought it'd be easy for people to mentally do that math. So with that, I'm going to pass it back to Kelly.
Thanks, Dan. And on the next slide, we'll get to the next key finding. So the other issue that we wanted to dive into is what role Americans want policymakers to play in retirement. I mean, we're here in Washington, a lot of you are in the States. For things to change, it's going to require some policy changes. So we really wanted to understand what Americans thought about the role of policymakers. And on the next slide, Americans told us that leaders really just don't get it about how hard it is to prepare for retirement. You can see there 87% in 2023 said that. It was up from 77% in 2020. And then in 2019, it was 83%. So, I mean, this is probably consistent with how Americans feel about Congress and their policymakers in general, that they just really don't get it on a whole host of issues. But, you know, I think a lot of the reasons why policymakers may not get it is, you know, maybe they have a financially secure retirement. I know we, Dan testified at a hearing last month before the Senate Help Committee with Senator Sanders. And in his opening remarks, he talked about, you know, we lawmakers here sitting up here have a pension. Why don't all Americans have a pension? So I think it's like it's an easy thing to understand when a lot of lawmakers, both at the state and federal level, they do have pensions or a fair amount of retirement security. So on the next slide, Americans also want policymakers to give retirement a higher priority. You can see that it's at 86% in 2023. In 2020, it was at 76%. In 2019, it was at 81%. And I will say, in fairness, lawmakers at the federal and both at the state level have been taking actions to give retirement a higher priority. The Secure Act and Secure 2.0 were passed in Washington, D.C. And then I'm sure all of you are familiar with all the actions that are happening at the state level to provide retirement plans to workers who don't have those through their employers, the so-called state facilitated plans. So, you know, Americans still want leaders to give it a higher priority. I was thinking for like the next polling, a good question to ask would be to see if people are familiar with the laws that have been enacted at the federal level, Secure and Secure 2.0. I suspect they probably haven't, and they probably haven't felt, even if they have heard of it, they may not have yet felt the impacts of those changes to the law and improving their retirement security. So that might be something to ask for next time. And then on the next slide, we can see here that back to pensions, Americans want lawmakers to find ways to make it easier to offer pensions. And referring back to that Senate Health, Education, Labor, and Pensions hearing that happened in February, where Dan testified, that was basically the topic of the hearing. Like, how do we make pensions available again to private sector workers? What policy changes need to happen to make that come to play? So that's definitely something that's being looked at the federal level. And then you can see here, 84% of Americans in 2023 wanted lawmakers to make that change to so that they can have access to a pension, and 77% in 2020. So it'll be interesting to see how all this plays out. And then on the next slide, we're going to talk a little bit about Social Security. I think everyone here knows Social Security funding is under pressure. The solvency numbers have changed, accelerating the date for solvency in recent, from the last trustees report, everyone probably saw. So I think that Social Security is always top of mind for Americans, especially older Americans. And as workers get near retirement age, it's very important. It's one of like the most beloved programs that the federal government has. So on the next slide, we can see that Americans don't want Congress to wait around to enact a solution. They want action now. 87% agree with that. And I mean, just if you look back at, you know, the other polling numbers and the other polling questions they've asked, you know, people are worried about retirement. So, you know, that I'm thinking that they want Social Security changes to happen now and the funding solution to be resolved now, because that might increase their sense of security about their retirement outlook. And then on the next slide, Americans want it to remain a policy issue, you know, no matter what the budget deficits are, no matter how bad funding is on other projects, they want Congress to continue to make Social Security a priority issue for Americans. And then on the next slide, now this one's interesting, like in terms of like getting to solutions, to solving the Social Security funding issue. Americans kind of see it as a two-way street here. They want both employers and employees to up their contributions. They just don't want it to fall on all on employees. So you can see here that high numbers of Americans do want those changes to happen from both employers and employees. And for this year, the numbers in 2023 were 58%. And then that's down slightly from 2020. It was at 60%. And then 2019, it was at 56%. So about half Americans want to see that joint effort put into solving the Social Security problem, funding issues. And then on the next slide, there are some proposals to expand Social Security. So, you know, make it a more generous type of a benefit. So, you know, we wanted to understand what Americans think about that. And it's split, 52% support expansion, but you'll see there's 25% say it should be expanded for all Americans. Another 27% say it should be expanded, but not for wealthier households. 28% say it should be kept as is. And then the remainder of the folks said that it should be reduced, but only for wealthier households, and should be reduced for all Americans. So, you know, that'll be interesting to see how that plays out, to see if there are efforts to actually expand the program in the coming years. And then on the next slide, I think I'm turning it over to Dan. Yep, and you're up next, Dan.
All right, thank you again. So I'm gonna do the next section, the next key finding. And Americans are really worried about long-term care costs in retirement. And this is something that we did some work on. You know, at first I thought it might be a niche issue that people weren't very familiar with. I really found that when talking about this in front of people, you could kind of see about one in three people really shaking their head. And, you know, I always assumed that that really showed that they had some personal experience with long-term care. So in the next slide, we ask, you know, about the concern of rising costs and long-term and nursing care. To what extent are they concerned? You know, almost half are very concerned, with an 80% overall concerned. And, you know, it really does make sense. The growing burden report we did, you know, we looked at not just the level of long-term care costs, but sort of how they're distributed. You know, you have about half of people that won't face much long-term care costs or none. And, you know, about 15%, we're going to face about $250,000 in long-term care costs. And that's really when you get these end-of-life diseases, dementia, Alzheimer's, I think accounts for a lot of that. And, you know, so long-term care is a major concern. I think a lot of people have touched the system either with a family member or, you know, a friend or something else. More people, I think, have interacted with this than I really realized. And on the next slide, we also ask about rising healthcare costs in retirement. Again, very concerned there. We have public programs that do a lot in terms of providing health insurance to our seniors. But there are certainly costs. And, you know, when you think about those costs compared to income levels, that can make it more challenging for seniors. So we see about 2/3 are concerned, with almost about 30% very concerned about rising healthcare costs. And then on the next slide, we also ask, and this is also an issue that we looked at in growing burden, 3/4 are concerned about the cost of housing in retirement. We've noted in growing burden that more people are carrying mortgages into retirement than in the past. And also rental costs has risen quite a bit in certain areas of the country. So I think it's not a big surprise that people would see housing costs as a barrier to secure retirement. But I think the level of agreement here really illustrates the point of how people understand their situation. So on the next slide, there are mixed views in terms of what a respondent said about the government sort of playing a role in funding long-term care. You know, we often look at retirement income, three-legged stool, right? We have a public program, you have a pension, you have savings, you know, employers are involved, individuals, all of us play a role in retirement saving, and you have a public program. And long-term care, we really don't see a forward-looking program to fund it, a public program. Employers typically don't offer long-term care benefits. And as individuals, we're not really saving specifically for long-term care. And again, with the distribution of costs, you know, you might not face any, or you might face a level of long-term care costs is extraordinarily high compared to the resources you might have in retirement. So there are mixed views here, but I think, you know, lacking a forward-looking program to fund long-term care, the outcome ends up being safety net programs, which now pay for more than half of long-term care costs in the country, simply because the costs are out of reach for individuals to manage that on their own. And with that, I think I'm passing this back to Kelly to talk about what's coming up.
Yep, on the next slide. So as Dan mentioned earlier, this opinion survey, it's very lengthy. I think we have a total of 70 questions, including like the demographic questions. So there's so much there. When we first would put out the report, we just put everything in the report. It was almost too much to digest. So going forward, what we're doing, we did this the last time we released the report, is we did the main report with the main findings, and then we broke out some of the data into like more bite-sized pieces. So if you recall, for the last opinion research, we put out an infographic about women. We put out an issue brief about how Americans felt about the state facilitated retirement programs that are happening in the states. So we're going to replicate that process again, because I think it seemed to work pretty well. People can digest like little segments of the research. You know, it's a lot more helpful that way, I think. So coming soon, we're working on an infographic right now that provides an overview about what women think of retirement, which is like obviously very important, because women are a lot of times not up as well as men when it comes to retirement, just because they live longer, they have lower wages, they take time out of the workforce, all those issues impacts their retirement security. So watch for an infographic coming about that soon, that we're going to do a piece. We have a whole section of the opinion research that asks Americans what they think about the state facilitated retirement plans. So we're going to do a research brief with those findings. We have some questions some of the questions we asked were in the main report about Social Security, but we asked additional questions. So we're going to do an issue brief about Americans' views about Social Security, and probably like diving into some of the demographic differences, like men and women and gender and those kinds of things. Then we're going to take a generational look at retirement, some of the differences between, you know, silent generation, boomers, Gen X, millennials, and how they feel about retirement. And then we also, every year we ask questions about what Americans think about public sector pension plans, so state and local retirement plans. So we're going to do an issue brief that looks at what Americans think about those public sector retirement plans. So watch for those coming soon. We're going to kind of trickle them out over the next couple of months, into the end of the year. You know, what's not on here too, I just realized, we're also going to do a look at how Americans feel about retirement politically. So the last report, we had one that looked at how do Republicans feel, how do Democrats feel, and how do independents feel about retirement. From the last survey, it was pretty much consistent. They were all very concerned about retirement. So we're going to do that, and we're going to release that around election time. So I left that off the list. So sorry about that. So watch for those coming soon. And then on the next slide, I just wanted to call out the opinion research. We're thrilled that it's getting so much attention in the news media. Yesterday, I think it was yesterday, but the day's confused this week, USA Today did a piece about the opinion research. They talked to Dan, and Dan is quoted extensively in it, and they use that American Dream data point in the research, in the story. And then Money did a piece on it, Pensions and Investments, CNBC, and a host of other ones, but those were some of the key highlights. So be sure to read those articles. And if you're on social media, we'd love it if you could, we've got them all posted on the NIRS social platform. So be sure to comment or share them on social media too, so they get a little bit more traction, and we'd really appreciate that. And with that, I think we're ready to take questions, right?
Yes. So feel free, everyone, to put your questions through the question and answer portion. I'll be asking Dan and Kelly your questions. So we have a few already that we can start out with. Do you have breakouts for each question by various demographic?
We do. Yes, we have. I think the demographics we have are gender, age, I can't remember all of them off the top of my head, but we do have a number of different demographics. So if you have specific questions about a specific question, just feel free to email us and we can provide you with that information.
I think income level, quite a bit of that.
Public sector versus private sector also is another demographic piece we have too.
Great. What was the most surprising finding of this report?
I'll give that one to you, Dan, right?
To me, and this is a new question that I really was interested in, the low awareness of how far a nest egg is going to go in retirement. Yeah, there's a very wide range of responses that we had, but I find it troubling that, you know, such a significant number of people believe $100,000 is going to generate $15,000, $20,000 of income in retirement. I think it's something that sort of gets left out a lot of times in terms of our efforts to, you know, educate people financially on financial matters.
Another question, why such strong support for pensions, do you think?
Do you want to go on that?
Yeah, I can do that one. I mean, I think it's a lot of like the safety and security of pensions. We did have like past versions of the polling. We did ask questions about like why exactly it is that you like pensions. And, you know, we didn't ask that this time around. But I mean, it's like set it and forget it. You know, you don't have to worry about managing your investments. You've got professional asset managers that are taking care of your retirement. And then to me, like the biggest benefit of pensions is that your retirement income is not going to run out. You're not going to outlive your savings, which is, you know, very easy to do with a 401k plan if the market fluctuates or you're not spending down at the right rate. So I mean, I think that's a lot of the reason why people are so comfortable with pensions. I don't know, do you have anything else to add, Dan?
Yeah, when we talk to people who work at retirement systems, I often say that, you know, you're providing an incredible service. Pensions are so user-friendly. You go to work, you do your actual job, and, you know, your employer or someone that your employer is participating in a pension plan, you know, they take these complicated issues, they use risk pooling, and they efficiently address one of the big financial challenges of your life. So I think it's an incredible service, you know, for the people that do have access.
Great. Another question, is the worry about retirement warranted?
I can start on this one. I think yes. I think when you look at the retirement risk index and people's responses, I think, you know, oftentimes we look at median data, like how is the 50th percentile person doing preparing for retirement? And there's always a big gap, and this came out at the HALP hearing. There's a big gap between the average savings and the median, simply because we know, you know, wealth has been more concentrated over time at the top. So the averages don't look that bad, but when you do look at the 50th percentile person, almost all the different, you know, groups that you might look at, the savings levels are pretty weak. And especially if you consider, you know, in the Gen X report, $40,000, if you consider the 4.4% rule, it's not going to provide the level of income. it does seem like a big number to people, but I don't think it's translating to income that well in their minds.
Okay. Another question. Someone's wondering if we have any data on public confidence that pensions won't be changed by companies or through negotiations with unions.
We did not ask that.
No. I think our question was geared towards the confidence they would get what they earned, but not future accruals. Does that sound right, Kelly?
Yes, that's right.
Okay. Another question. I saw one reference to a JP Morgan study of efficiency of pensions. Do you have data, not public opinion data necessarily, that they provide more money for beneficiaries?
So we can share that report with you. And we also have our own report that looks at the economic efficiency of pensions versus DC plans, the Better Bang for the Buck 3.0. And that's in the research tab of our website. But yeah, we go through and talk about how, you know, the pooling of risk and managing post-retirement with risk pooling, you know, it takes that, I might live 2 years in retirement or 30 years in retirement, and it, you can sort of plan for an average of a long, large group. And we found that most of the efficiency advantage, it's not actually the years in the defined contribution plan, it's post-retirement. Is 4/5 of the efficiency advantage. So it's those years when you leave your plan and you say, okay, now what am I going to do with my money? Who's going to manage it? Those are actually, you know, what we found that to be the major culprit in the efficiency gap there.
Next question. Why is the financial services industry fighting any return to pensions so aggressively?
I don't know that the financial services industry is, you know, there's different lanes of work in retirement, but I think there's a sense of at a lot of employers that the way pensions used to be done, they're all done that way. It's the only way you can do it. I think that's not true. You know, if you think of where we were in say the 50s with pensions, we were coming back and saying, oh, people are living longer. And we were surprised. Today, that's all baked into the cake. We know that we're planning for future longevity improvement. You know, the financial models that actuaries use today are far superior than the pencil and paper that was used, you know, in the early years. And there's a lot more plan designs meant to leave less risk on the shoulders of employers. But I think it was employers who, you know, have bought into the conventional wisdom that the pensions are too risky and they can't manage it. Not really the financial services industry.
Great. Could you explain what is meant by efficiency of pension plans versus a 401k?
Sure. Essentially, we looked at how much it would take to create the same benefit in a 401k as it would in a pension. And the costs were essentially about twice as much, with most of that, again, attributable to the post-retirement years. So it's really like, if you were going to set a target benefit level and, you know, save throughout your career to hit that target level, how much would it cost in a pension versus a DC plan? And that's really what Better Bang for the Buck does.
And for the, when I was trying to understand it, when NIRS first put this report out, it's sort of like, this is like a very simple way of putting it, but it's like 7-Eleven versus Costco. Like there's a lot more efficiencies with Costco. You get a lot more price efficiency versus like the individual pricing at like a 7-Eleven. There's just so many reasons why the pensions are more efficient, but that's kind of a, that's how I kind of like explain it to myself being the non-financial person.
Yeah. And, you know, if it sounds odd, I would say, you know, a 25-year-old can invest very aggressively and that's great, but most 25-year-olds don't have a large pool of dollars. When you should have your highest amounts of dollars in your 401k, it's as you approach retirement, post-retirement, and then it's really not as appropriate to invest the same way that, you know, a pension can that always has a longer term investment horizon, right? So if you say, how should I manage these dollars? One of the first questions you'll probably be asked is, well, when do you need it? It's a big factor in how we invest.
And it looks like this is our last question that we have. So if you have anything that's on your mind that you've been wanting to ask, speak now or forever hold your peace.
Or call us later.
Sure. Or, you know, email us. We're around. Okay. This question is, would be fascinating to do a trade-off analysis among employers and workers in terms of benefits now, such as childcare or aging parental support, student loan and financial health support, and fertility benefits versus pension investments. They're wondering if there's maybe a generational difference, and they wanted to know what you thought about that.
I think that's an interesting question. Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's a great idea. And I suspect there are some generational, at least some benefits that would be different amongst generations, but I think that that's a great concept.
The other, someone else suggested to me, like, another good question to ask would be, how much are you willing to, like, sacrifice on your salary now for, like, a pension benefit? So sacrificing pay now for, like, a bigger payout in retirement. So I thought that was kind of interesting also. Oh, it looks like a couple more questions came in, Maggie.
Great. First question, did any group outside of NIRS fund this research?
No.
The public opinion research? No, that was NIRS. And we are a membership organization. So, you know, if our members join, they contribute to NIRS, and then we paid for the study.
Next question. Have lower pensions led to higher wages in a way that holds employers' costs constant?
I think it's difficult to generalize on that. There's a lot of specific contexts in terms of when benefits were changed. But the years when pension plans became offered more infrequently in the private sector, certainly wasn't an era where middle-class wages were going up fast. You know, everybody talked about middle-class wages lagging for the last 30, 40 years. And that's sort of the same time frame. So there's a cost of pensions, there's a cost of saving in DC plans, you know, and there's a cost of not doing that as well.
Well, thank you both. That's all we have for questions.
So thank you again, Kelly. Thanks to the team at Greenwald for all their work, and thank you to everybody joining us today. We're easy to find, so please feel free to reach out if you have a question about this or an idea that you'd like to share with us. You know, it's a great community of folks we work with, and you know, it really makes working here and doing the work we do enjoyable. So any final thoughts, Kelly?
No, just thanks, and look out for the upcoming research stemming from this report. So
all right.
Thanks.
Goodbye.